How are we doing? How are we doing? Okay, fine. Good. I'll draw a card. Liam. Where are you, Liam? Liam
here? He's flying right under the radar.
Where's Liam?
He called out.
He might be here today.
Liam.
He has a little bend in
Huh.
It's fun.
I'm going to put his card aside so I can draw it if he shows up. Ryan Short, where are you, Ryan?
Oh, yeah, hey, what's up?
Ryan, hey, you ready?
Oh, probably not.
I'll just say yeah.
Yeah.
All right, let's do it. All right, awesome. Let's do it. No, today is awesome. Today is truly, I mean, I told you last time was one of my favorite topics. I forgot how good today is. Today is rad. Today, we're going to learn about spinners.
Woo.
I know. So, is he really going to run around?
Yeah.
She or he?
He.
He's
3 months. Like, I can't.
Okay, all right. Fine.
You should just, like, pick him up and check
okay,
him.
Okay, it's fine. It's fine. Okay, so, in three dimensions, and when I say three dimensions here, I'm talking about three spatial dimensions, so X, Y, and Z. There's no time in this story. In three dimensions, our discussion of rotations has led us to encounter things like scalars, vectors, and then the generalization of both of these, which is arbitrary tensors, okay? These are zero, three component and higher. I mean, generally a tensor can be a scalar, or a scalar is a tensor, a vector is a tensor, but higher order tensors have more than three components. And when I write down zero, three, or higher, it's also a question of, if I want to do a transformation, what dimensionality of matrix do I need? So if I'm hitting something that has three components, I obviously need a 3x3 matrix. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. What the hell are y'all thinking?
Just wanted to see your point.
Okay, so the big question is, what about 2D? And I don't mean, what about 2D rotations? I mean, what about a two-dimensional representation of a three-dimensional rotation? Okay, do they exist? So, okay, so what we need in order to get a two-dimensional representation is we need 2x2 matrices which satisfy what definition of our group? Eric Benson. What definition of our group can we use where 2x2 matrices is even an option? Is it 3x3 matrices?
No.
No. 3x3 matrices are not 2x2 matrices, but we abstracted into math land and settled on, if we define our group with this, then we can probably get other representations out.
Multiplication table?
No, that's only going to be useful for a discrete finite group, and these are continuous Lie groups that we're dealing with. You want to phone a friend? Okay, who you want to phone?
Lie algebra.
Yeah, you want to use the Lie algebra, okay? So, remember, a Lie algebra is the commutator between generators. This is GI, GJ, minus GJ, GI. I'll write it up there just to remind you. This is GI, GJ, minus GJ, GI. And if we're dealing with rotation, then this takes the form I, epsilon, IJ, K, GK. Okay? Okay, where again, I, J, and K take values 1, 2, and 3. And this is because we're in 3D, And so if we work out the various examples, we have G1, G2 equals I and J are 1, 2. So which component of epsilon IJK is non-zero if I and J are 1 and 2?
3.
Epsilon 1, 2, 3. But epsilon 1, 2, 3 has what value? 1. Okay, I listed all the values of epsilon IJK last time, so you want to look it up. So this is just IG3. And then actually, if we just go down the cyclic permutations, those are three examples of the Lie algebra. You can do other examples. You can do G1, but what's the commutator of G1, G1? Say it loud, say it proud.
Zero.
G1, G1 minus G1, G1 is zero, okay? All right, you ready? Now remember, last time I showed you 3x3 matrices which satisfied this algebra. And of course, those are the 3x3 generators which underlie the 3x3 rotation matrices. Now we would like to find 2x2 matrices which will underlie 2x2 transformation matrices. Here we go. So we can have a YZ, which is 0, 1 half, 1 half, 0. A GR ZX, which is 0. getting squirrely down there. This is going to be fun. GR XY. Good Lord. 1 half, 0, 0, minus 1 half. And I should write the 1 half fractions the same, but hey, I'm up for diversity. Okay? All right. Do these matrices look familiar?
They kind of look like that. What do I think we were talking about?
What do they look like? They're almost Pauli matrices. This is 1 half the Pauli matrix sigma x. This is 1 half the Pauli matrix sigma y, and this is 1 half the Pauli matrix, which we call sigma z. Okay? Sigma x, sigma y, sigma z are the Pauli spin matrices. Okay. So, now, just to remind you of the way that the story went, in looking for three-dimensional representations of rotations in 3D, we started with a 3x3 matrix. Okay? This was our expression for RYZ, for example. Okay? And then we used the fact that this should be writable as the exponential of I times, and my notation then was, I think, yeah, GRYZ times theta. Okay? And then we expanded this in a Taylor series, and it allowed us to pick out the matrices corresponding to the generators of this matrix. These were also 3x3 matrices, but these are not the rotation operators, these are the generators. You have to exponentiate them to get the actual rotation matrix. Then we took this and we found the three different generators, and then we constructed the algebra. Okay, now what I want to do is I want to start with the algebra and I want to find 2x2 G's. And now I want to work backwards and ask, okay, what is a 2x2 matrix? What is a 2x2 matrix? Well, how am I going to figure out what the 2x2 matrix looks like? What am I going to do? Any guesses what expression I should use for a 2x2 matrix representation of a rotation operator in 3D? Yeah! God dang it! I'm gonna stop cursing. All right, fuck it, I'll curse. Yeah, this is the definition that holds. If you want, if you've got a generator and you want to form the actual transformation operator, you just exponentiate the generator. Of course, now that we have 2x2 matrices for the generators, that tells us we're going to get 2x2 matrices for our rotation operator. Everybody follow? Good, okay. So let's actually work out what the 2x2 matrix looks like. And we have RYZ of theta is e to the I g, the generator of RYZ, which is this guy right here, times the angle theta. And that just works out to be cosine theta over 2, I sine theta over 2, I sine theta over 2, cosine theta over 2. Okay? And similarly for an RZX and an RXY, I'll just work with this as an example though. Okay? Now, it's interesting. Is this an element of SO3? Joshua?
Well, it's not 3x3.
Right, it's not.
It looks like it would be an element of
SO2. Okay, it looks like it would be an element of SO2. Let's think about that though. SO2 has how many generators? Me and you, in a conversation.
One.
But how many generators do we have for this?
Three.
Okay? So now we're in a bit of a pickle. We know this isn't SO3, which has three generators. It can't be SO2, which is convenient because it's 2x2, but it can't be SO2 because SO2's only got one generator. So what other option do you think we have at our disposal? Okay, Ross?
SU2.
Yes, these are examples of SU2. Now let's think about this for a moment. First of all, remember if you're stating, if you're working with unitary matrices, these are matrices which have imaginary components. Right? Well, these have imaginary components. So this is one important piece of information. To go from 3x3 real matrices to 2x2 matrices incorporating the same information, you have to introduce complex numbers. You should remember this from your first homework. When you were rotating that square and you had to use an 8-component thing, and then you wanted to try and describe it using a 1-component thing, you definitely had to go complex, okay? So you can actually demonstrate, though, by looking at this, that this satisfies U dagger U equals the identity. Okay, well, remember, the dagger is complex conjugate transpose. Okay, you just multiply that out, and you'll get the identity. And, of course, you'll also find that the determinant of this is plus 1. Okay, satisfying the conditions that define special and unitary. You got a question?
Yeah.
Yeah, go for it. What the three generators are. So physically, fuck the math. Physically, we're doing rotations in 3 dimensions. Okay? And I know that if I have, say, a vector and I want to rotate it around x, y, and z. If I want to take this vector and I want to rotate it around the x-axis, or in the yz plane, I should say, if I can rotate it a little bit in the yz plane, then I can take that little bit and just compound it to get any rotation I want in the yz plane. Okay? So my question is, in order to build an arbitrary rotation in 3 dimensions, how many little nuggets of rotation do you need from which you can build an arbitrary thing?
Like
So if you're in two dimensions, the answer is obviously just one. If you can rotate a little bit, then you can compound them and rotate many. In three dimensions, it turns out there's three independent things. You can rotate in basically the XZ plane, the ZY plane, and the XY plane, or around the X-axis, the Y-axis, and the Z-axis, if you prefer to talk about axes. Those are physically what the generators are.
Okay.
Mathematically, we extract them from the actual matrices that do the transformations by demanding that the matrix of a transformation correspond to the exponential of I times a generator times an angle. And then you just do a Taylor expansion and you match things and you'll find what these G's are.
Okay.
But the G's are not themselves transformations. You have to put them into the exponent in order to get a transformation matrix.
So by looking at that, how do you know that there are three generators just because we have...
Oh, I'm using these three matrices.
Okay. So you would have to have that. You can't just look at the...
At the algebra?
No, the whole like e to the I, g, r, y, z, theta. Can you look at that and say there are three generators?
Oh, yeah. So if you wanted to write a general rotation, then you would write e to the I, g, a, theta, a, where this a goes over whatever number of generators you have, which in this case is three.
Okay.
And then you have three angles you can rotate by.
Okay.
All right? Any other questions? Okay. So, okay, so this is SU2, which acts on, how many dimensions is the thing this acts on? Two. Could it be complex? Yeah, it's really hard to act with complex matrices and have the results always be real. What's a two-dimensional complex object in physics?
A spinner?
Yes, thank you.
Spinner.
So spinners are the things that these rotations act on. Okay. Conversely, a vector is what the 3x3 rotation matrices act on.
What's he gonna get? What's he gonna get? What's he gonna get?
I just forgot something in the room.
Oh, I thought you were joining the class. Dang. Okay. All right. Okay.
Get wrecked,
Alex. Yeah. All right. So usually, if we want to write down the transformation of a spinner, we would hit it with this matrix, which we can write as the exponential. But our notation for spinners is going to be e to the 1/2 sigma dot theta times chi. Okay. Because now we can actually represent our transformation in terms of the Pauli matrices. Okay, we just have to use 1/2 the Pauli matrices. Yes?
Did we ever like say what the Pauli matrices were? Like where did that just come from? Like that, those words?
Oh, sorry, where are the words Pauli? Actually,
like, I remember going over these,
you don't,
like,
look,
things,
look, no, no,
like,
no, no, no,
what?
No, no, hold on, chill out. First of all, hold up. I'm going to talk to you about, in depth, the Pauli matrices in a moment.
Okay.
For now, though, the Pauli matrices are just the matrices that play this role. That's their role in quantum mechanics.
Okay.
It's just, I need a factor of 1/2 in order for this map to make sense, and we'll eventually see why that factor of 1/2 has to be there. Yes?
So what is a spinner?
Wasn't that one of the questions on the final last time?
That is a beautiful question. All right, so for now, what I will say, and I would have said this eventually, is there are rotations in three dimensions. We can all agree on what a rotation in three dimensions is, right?
Yeah.
What is a rotation in three dimensions? Well, it's interesting because what you're rotating is a vector. Rotations, though, admit the possibility that there exist these two-dimensional things which undergo rotations in three dimensions. You can't hold your hand up and do that. Your hand is the vector. Your finger is a vector. Okay? So spinners are not as physical. Remember when I did my definition of cosine theta, I said we got to get the hell away from a physical definition of it? Well, we got the hell away from a physical definition of rotation group, and now we're discovering things which are not nearly as physical, but they're still relevant. These are a representation of rotations in three dimensions. They are things upon which rotations in three dimensions are well-defined, satisfy the underlying algebra. They just happen to be two-dimensional. They're not physical in the sense of what is physical. Physical is where you can draw coordinates, because coordinates span the space, and then you can draw a vector in those coordinates, and you can talk about how that rotates. Spinners are more abstract things. Whether they're important in physics or not is an open question. It's not an open question. It's an open question for now that I'll answer in a couple of days. But maybe I'll answer it today. I don't know. I haven't read my notes. But the spinners could be important if things exist that actually transform this way. Yeah.
This is actually just clarification. You have e to the 1/2. What are those next two symbols?
Oh, sorry. So you'll notice that there's a sigma x, a sigma y, and a sigma z. Sigma x, this is sigma vector.
Okay.
So this is sigma vector dotted with a vector of angles.
Okay.
But the angles are the parameters. So normally, I wrote it and I erased it. Normally, to write an arbitrary rotation, you would do something like this. This is just the same, it's the same notation. Okay? Yeah.
Sorry, could you argue that the incorporation of the I gives the spinner another dimension for which to...
No. The I is not playing the role of another dimension. And we're going to actually see towards the end of this class a very, very important manifestation of that. Okay? It's going to rock your world, trust me. Trust me, it's going to rock your world. Okay. But I'm halfway through my first page of notes. This sucks. Okay, so one of the things that we can say is that there is a sense in which, hold on. Yeah, yes, something I want to go ahead and point out, because you're going to get scared of it later on. You'll notice that these spinners, they don't have indices. Spinners are two-component objects, so you could imagine that chi would have like an index I, and you would have chi 1 and chi 2. Okay, it's just a convention in particle physics, but for spinners we don't do index notation. So that means that when we're talking about everything with spinners, transformations of them, making invariants of them, matrix multiplication is the underlying tool, which means order matters. Okay? So unlike the tensors where we were comfortable using index notation, for spinners we're not. But that's, you know, it's just the way it goes. Okay, so first of all, let me ask a question. You know, does it make sense to argue that SO3 is somehow related to SU2? I mean, these two groups are pretty close to the same. I mean, they have the same set of generators. If you do 2x2 complex matrices, then they end up satisfying U dagger U equals I and det U equals plus 1. But if you use 3x3 real matrices, they end up satisfying that O transpose, or lambda transpose lambda equals the identity, the orthogonality condition. So, you know, maybe these two groups sort of are kind of the same. I mean, yeah, this is 3x3 matrices, this is 2x2 matrices, but at their heart, maybe they're the same. Okay? What do you think? You're about the same? I ain't gonna let you answer. No, Ross, no. The dog's out. Okay. Okay, so let me actually explain something to you. First of all, we extracted the Lie algebra of SO3. There it is. The Lie algebra is based on the generators. The generators are tiny rotations, so they're just barely getting away from the identity. The identity is zero rotation, and then you're just moving a delta phi away from the identity. SU2 has the same damn Lie algebra. So this Lie algebra is describing tiny SU2 transformations. Okay? So near the origin, these are the same. But we can ask, is that true globally? And you'll remember I said, if you've got a little area of an infinite plane versus a little area of a cylinder, this neighborhood is the identical same as that neighborhood, because this is a flat space. This is a flat space. This, though, is topologically different than this. So things can be the same near the origin, but topologically they can disagree. Well, let's see if these topologically disagree. If I take RYZ for a 3x3 matrix, and I rotate by 2 pi, RYZ, if I rotate by 2 pi, cosine 2 pi is 1, sine of 2 pi, there you go. Everybody on? If I take the 2x2 matrices and I rotate by 2 pi, then again I'll get the identity. Because cosine theta over 2 is, if theta is pi over, or 2 pi.
Oh, so cosine over 2 is going to be 1 half.
So what is cosine of pi, people?
It's
negative 1. What's sine of pi?
0.
Sine of pi, 0. Well, shit.
Oh, I thought you were saying like cosine of theta and then divide by 2.
Oh, but Alex, that's not the identity.
That's not the identity.
That's not what we wanted.
So what you'll notice is that even though locally these two things are very much the same, globally they're different. Globally, 2 pi is the identity. So if you go past 2 pi, you basically repeat the cycle of the entire group. However, with spinners, 2 pi is minus the identity. It's not the identity. So to get the identity, what do you need?
4 pi.
Yeah, you need 4 pi. Which hopefully is obvious. So what you'll notice is that this is a degenerate representation compared to this. If you go back to my representation notes where I was showing you what degenerate representations are, if you have a representation that has, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 elements, and then you have another representation that only has 2, well, these are the maps. Okay. And a similar sort of mapping is happening here, because here both R2 pi and R4 pi get mapped to this. So this is degenerate. Right? So these groups are very similar, but they're different on a global sense. Now, there is a certain sense in which this more faithful representation, the spinner is a more faithful representation of rotations than vectors are. You think vectors got it all, but they don't. Okay, yes?
Faithful, like, to what?
Faithful as in, if the group admits more distinct elements, like if it admits 100 distinct elements, and that's literally the number of elements in the group, then any representation that exhibits all 100 elements is faithful. But a representation that only exhibits 50 is unfaithful.
But I guess we were saying that, like, in R3, like rotations in R3 represented by 3x3 matrices, like you can create a faithful representation of that, but now we're saying that that's degenerate, but like degenerate
so yeah. So here's the thing. I am not defining, so SO3 is a group, and a 3x3 matrix is a faithful representation of SO3.
Okay.
But what I'm working with is not SO3, it's not SU2. What I'm working with is this group.
Okay.
Which we were associating with SO3, but what we're discovering now is actually SO3 is not uniquely associated with rotations in 3D. SU2 can be associated with, and SU2 is a more faithful representation. All right, now, here's one argument that says spinners probe the geometry more deeply than vectors and tensors and so forth. But let me give you another reason. And this is one that's going to play a role later on. There is a sense in which spinners know something about the square root of the geometry. One, yeah. The square root squared is one. Or no, it's not one, but it's the original thing. Okay, actually, there is a very sincere way of expressing how spinners know about the square root of the geometry. And to do this, we're going to consider the anti-commutator of the Pauli matrices. So an anti-commutator is written with those kinds of brackets, and sigma I, sigma j. So what does the anti-commutator mean? It means you multiply the two together, and then you add what you get if you reverse their order. Anti-commutators do not play such an important role in quantum mechanics. That's mostly commutators, but anti-commutators are going to play an important role here. But they're just literally the same as a commutator, but you plus instead of minus. Okay? You ready? The commutator of the sigmas just gives you back another sigma. The anti-commutator doesn't. The anti-commutator gives you this. Now, this thing, is that a Lie algebra?
Say no.
No, it's not a Lie algebra, it's half a commutator. Anybody know what this algebra is called? It's a Clifford algebra.
It's not red, though.
It's not red.
You shouldn't have thrown away that marker.
Why does...
Huh?
I don't know what the hell you're talking about. Okay. Now, in all seriousness, okay. So I've written down a couple of examples of just, you know, taking sigma 1, sigma 2, or sigma x, sigma y, multiplying them, adding their reverse order, and then showing you that, well, actually, I'll do at least one. So I'll do sigma x, sigma y, plus sigma y, sigma x. Okay, now all I'm gonna do is grab these matrices. I'm gonna grab the sigmas, so twice these. And I'm going to multiply them together, add them together. And I'm doing this because, what does that give me?
Zero.
Gives me zero. Now, according to this expression, why did it give me zero? Yeah, because there's a delta ij here. This is the Kronecker delta, and it's basically one if the I and the j have the same values, and it's zero if they have different values, okay? In my notes, I do sigma y plus sigma y, and I end up getting 2 times the identity. So if I do the commutator sigma y, I'll end up with 2 times the 2 by 2 identity matrix. Okay? So does everybody understand how this formula works? This is just the 2 by 2 identity matrix, 1, 1. This is a Kronecker delta, which this thing is only a number, 1 or 0, based on the assignment of the indices here. Okay? Now here's the really interesting part. Because didn't I say sigmas are the square root of the geometry? I said that shit, didn't I? What is this? That's the Kronecker delta. But if I think about it, what values do I and j take?
1 and 2.
What values do I and j take?
X,
y, z. So if I wrote this as a matrix, what would it look like? It would be the identity in 3 by 3. Well, what is the identity in 3 by 3 if you're using x, y, z? It's the metric. Now here, that looks stupidly trivial. This is the identity that happens to be the metric. Who gives a crap? Okay, but in a minute, it's going to play a huge role. Okay, go ahead. No, this is 3 spatial dimensions. This is rotations in x, y, z, okay? But notice, if I'm squaring these, I get the metric. So one of these is the square root of the metric. That's the sense in which these sigmas are carrying information about the square root of the metric, or the geometry, okay? Now, one last comment, and then we're gonna move on. In quantum mechanics, so remember this because we'll play with this in a bit. In quantum mechanics, there is a sense in which spinners are more fundamental than scalar or vector particles, okay? Because think about it, in quantum mechanics, if I give you a particle with spin 1, or if I give you a collection of particles with spin 1, what can you build by combining them? If I take 2 spin 1 particles and I anti-align their spins, what do I get? If I anti-align their spins, what do I get? Yeah, I can build a spin 0 particle. I can take 1 spin 1 particle, and what spin do I get? 1. What if I take 2 and I align their spins? Spin 2. Okay? And I can get any integer spin I want. Now, there is a connection that I'm using, but I want to be careful. Spin 1 particles are represented by vectors. Okay, so the spin is associated with the transformation representation. A spin 1 particle is a vector, a spin 0 particle is a scalar, a spin 2 particle is a rank 2 tensor. Okay? But the point is if all I give you is spin 1, then the only thing you can build is integer spin particles. Of course, if I give you spin 0 particles, what can you build? Shit, you can build spin 0 particles, okay? Okay, however, this is interesting. What if I give you spin 1/2 particle? What can you build?
Pretty much anything.
Yeah, can you build a spin 0 state?
Sure.
Yeah, you anti-align the 2 spin 1/2s, you get 0. You take 1 spinner, you get 1/2. You take 2 spinners in the same direction, you get 1, et cetera, et cetera. So yet again, notice, if you have a spin 1/2 starting point, you have more at your disposal than if you have a spin 1 starting point. Spinners are richer than vectors. Okay? All right. Now, let me bust through an invariance in terms of the spinner and its dual, and then we'll move on to the real part of the story. Okay. So if we want to build an invariant out of a spinner, okay, we know how to do this. We've seen how to build invariants. After you have a representation, all you do is you form the dual, and then you have a certain combination of the dual element and the original element. So here we go. So the element chi, the spinner, transforms as chi prime e to the I over 2 sigma dot theta. And we can imagine that if the dual spinner transforms as e to the I over 2 sigma dot theta inverse dagger chi twiddle, then if these two are both true, then chi twiddle dagger chi is going to be an invariant.
Alex, did you miss a chi in that first one, like at the end of it?
Oh, yeah, sorry. Thank you. Okay. Now, this is exactly what I had done when I was doing SO3 for you. Okay? The only difference is that the daggers were transposes. And I was just writing, like, lambda here instead of this exponential, but I'm going to use the exponential for my transformation matrix. Okay? But do I need to show you why this is true? Or can you see it? Who needs to see why this is true? Raise your hand. Not a damn hand. Okay, all right.
If you don't want to do it, if you don't want to do it.
Okay, but remember, so this is how the dual has to transform, but how can we figure out what the chi twiddle looks like? I mean, it's got to transform like this, but what does it look like? And if we want to know how to get a dual representation, Jelone is going to tell me how to get a dual representation if I'm starting with an element of the original representation. What do I apply?
No, I couldn't tell you what it is, but I know what you're talking about.
Uh-huh.
You might know somewhere I could look for it, but it's a while.
What do you apply?
The metric.
Yeah, you apply the metric. Good.
Yeah.
Okay, nice. Okay, now, the metric has to satisfy that a transformation on it, daggered, g, e to the I over 2 sigma dot theta, is equal to g. Okay, this is true in general. But I can use this and something else I know to figure out what G is, and then that tells me how to form a dual. Okay? So, wait a minute. What group are we working with?
SU2.
So we know that for SU2, if I call this the transformation U, we know that U dagger U equals 1. So what is G? G is the identity. Okay? So that means that chi twiddle is the same as chi. So if I give you a spinner, the dual spinner has the same components. Okay? But that means that chi dagger chi is an invariant. Because chi dual dagger chi is going to be an invariant, but if chi dual is just chi, then this is chi dagger chi is an invariant. Okay? Okay. Now, there's one more thing that I'm going to say, and then we'll be done. And all right. So here's an interesting question. U dagger, according to this relationship, You can also think of as U inverse. Yeah. Because if I take this and I hit U with it, I get the identity. So this has got to be U inverse. Well, let's look at this for a minute. So let's take a U. What do you think U inverse looks like? I mean,
it's going to be negative.
Yeah, yeah, it's probably just going to have a negative here.
Why?
Well, because this times this, it's going to be 1, right? The exponentials will add to 0. But here's the thing. U inverse is supposed to be U dagger. So if I dagger this, this is I over 2 sigma dot theta quantity daggered. Does daggering this just give me a minus sign?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, what does it do to I? It turns into minus I. Oh, wait a minute. The sigmas have I's in them. Whoa! Hold on! Hold! Whoa! The sigmas have I's in them. So it could be that the sigmas actually change when you dagger. Which is pretty reasonable. I mean, I dagger you, you'll change. All right? Does everybody see the potential problem?
Yes. Yeah.
Good. Here's the resolution. Does anybody have the sigmas in front of them? What can you tell me about daggering a sigma? Yeah. That's changing the I's to minus I's, minus I's to I's, and transposing. Yes, all of the sigmas are unchanged. These are called what?
Permission.
Okay? So it is the fact that the sigmas are Hermitian. This is just a vector of angles, so don't worry about it, it's real. These are Hermitian, so the only thing that actually changes when I dagger this is that I right there gets a minus sign, which is exactly what you'd expect for the inverse. Okay? And if you're worried and you're like, oh, but that's an exponential, how do you dagger an exponential? You know, this, it's a major, you know, just Taylor expand the damn thing and dagger every term. I have an example of it in my notes and micro right on the board, but you can Taylor expand this, dagger each and every term, and then resum it, and you'll get exactly that. Okay? Questions? Good. Now the shit's gonna get real. What I have just stood here and told you about are the spinners you learn about in quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, are you doing shit that's relativistic? Hell no. We got to do relativity in this class. So now, let's go to 4D.
Okay.
With T, X, Y, and Z. And you can put a little C there if you want. Okay? So in 4D, we have the Lorentz transformations now. These are the set of space-time transformations we're interested in, not just the set of rotations. And you should remember that the Lorentz transformations can be cast in terms of an SO1, 3 group. The SO3 part is just the three spatial rotations, but then when you mix in the time, you can get the boosts, which is basically a rotation between a time and a spatial coordinate. How many generators do we expect?
3, 6.
Okay, we expect the rotations. And then we expect boost generators. Okay? Well, actually, these aren't generators. These are rotation matrices. I've written those down before. Okay? These are 4x4 rotation matrices, but really all they are is they're the identity here, and then there are 3x3 rotation matrix here. That's what these three are. And then the boosts do something non-trivial here. And then with regards to, and I can't remember exactly what it is, maybe something like this.
That's it.
So this is an XT boost matrix. Now, these matrices act on four component vectors, which include the position vector, okay? Each of these is going to have a generator. And we're going to call these generators J1, J2, J3, and then we'll call the boost generators K1, K2, and K3. Okay? Now, what I would like to do is now repeat the story that we did for SO3, where we take the 4x4 matrices, extract the generators, get the Lie algebra, and then see what else we can get from it. Okay? And of course, you know what that's going to be. It's going to be a relativistic spinor, which is very different than a non-relativistic spinor. So let's start with the J's. For the J's, the rotation generators are actually something you could probably guess. Why could you guess that? Yeah, this is the same generator that we had for RYZ in 3x3 rotations, and we just tacked on this time like row and column with all zeros, okay? So you should also be able to write down J2 and J3. Take these and you do commutators to form the Lie algebra of just this set of generators, what do you think you're going to get? Any takers?
Let me submit a J.
Yeah, you're going to get the same damn thing we got for rotations in three dimensions. Look, these are the generators from the 3x3 case. They just got this extra row and column, but it's all zero. It's not going to mess with anything. Okay? So these are 4x4 matrices. That's a 4x4 matrix, but there's only three of them. Yes, it's weird, but yeah. Well, there's three generators in rotation. Okay? Now let's do the boosts. Now, the boost generators are not obvious at all because we haven't done anything like a boost, but I'll just write down what they are, Ki or K1. K1, where in the matrix do you think the boost generators are going to be non-trivial? Yeah, in the top row and the top column, okay? And so actually, all we're doing is we're distributing, bless you. All we're doing is we're taking a minus sign and we're distributing it in terms of this is the KXT, so we'll put it in the X spot, KYT, put it in the Y spot, KZT, put it in the Z spot. It doesn't touch the 3x3. Okay? All right. So remember, rotations you can write as e to the ij times phi. You know, where we do like J1. And for boosts, a boost matrix, you would write as e to the I beta V over C, that's the parameter. Okay, so with the generators, you can build up an arbitrary rotation or a boost matrix using the exponential map.
Why is that betas and not k's? In the exponent?
Oh, sorry. This is a beta. This is a beta, this is a k. Thank you. Yeah. Okay, so what have I not written for you? Yeah, I should stop whimpering and write down the damn Lie algebra of the boost generators, right? And it's going to be pretty much exactly the same as the Lie algebra for the rotation generators, except there's going to be a minus sign. Okay.
Is that supposed to be J?
Huh? Oh shit, J's the generator of what? Rotation. Yes, it's supposed to be a J. If you take the commutator of two boosts, congratulations, you've created a rotation generator. Yes?
What if you do a commutator of a rotation and a boost?
Damn, that is the next thing I was going to say. If we do a commutator of a rotation and a boost, we get I epsilon ijk times a boost. Yeah.
Ow.
Well, first of all, Avery, you ain't gotta accept it. Take this times this minus this times this, and you'll get one of these. Trust me. Okay, yeah.
Is that supposed to be J-I-K-I? Or?
Yeah, this, so,
or would it be J?
These are, this is a rotation.
Well,
this is boost.
It should be J-I-K-J.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And then this is a rotation boost. Okay. Let me ask you a question. Do you think that rotations by themselves form a subgroup of SO1,3? What do you think?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, they do. I mean, you got to have the identity, but this is that's a rotation matrix. You've got to have closure. You take any two rotations, you combine them, you better get another rotation. Well, the algebra is telling us two rotations give you a rotation. You got to have the inverse. Well, if you got a rotation is the inverse of a rotation. And you got to have associativity, but you're using matrix multiplication. Associativity is already guaranteed. Let me ask you another question. Do you think that the boosts form a subgroup of SO1,3?
No.
Hell no, they don't. Because if you take two boosts, you get a rotation. That's breaking closure. All right? So, there is a sense in which this could have been fucking awesome if the boosts had formed their own group, these were their own group, and then we could have just played with this group the same way we played with it in three dimensions, and we could have played with this group and whatever the hell it is, and then the answer would be rotations times boosts, but it ain't that easy. So let me show you what we gotta do. And this is a trick which many of you are gonna be like, really? I've seen that so many times before, but let's do it. First of all, my aim is to break this up into two different groups. Okay, and you'll understand why in a minute. But let's play an old math physics trick.
Oh yeah.
Define J plus I as 1/2 J I plus K I. That's a plus is a is the combination, the additive combination of a rotation and a boost generator, all with the same index. So if I'm going in the X direction, this is, or the one, this is one, one, and one. And then you might guess J minus is 1/2 JI minus KI. Okay? We all good? And you can literally sit down and write, you can write down what these are. I mean, I had all the matrices on the board, so you can take J1 minus K1, and that'll give you J minus 1. It's that simple. Now, once you've created all these matrices, because multiplying 4 by 4 matrices is so much fun, you can then extract their the algebra, yes. And here's their Lie algebra. J plus I, J plus J is I epsilon I J K, J plus K. J minus I, J minus J is I epsilon I J K, J minus K. Check that shit out. You know what, it gets even better. What do you think that that's equal to? I know! So unfortunately, if you take a collection of rotations and a collection of groups, or sorry, boosts, you can't say that the Lorentz transformations break down into two individual groups. Okay? However, there's nothing that says you can't change your basis. So why don't we consider these six elements, 3 and 3? And the very clean thing about considering these six elements is that it breaks down into two different groups. Okay? Moreover, what group does this Lie algebra describe?
SO3 and SU2.
Well, it just, I mean, so we're talking about 3 by 3 matrices for the moment, so. These are illustrating an SO3. So what we can say is that SO1 comma 3, based on the matrices, is equivalent to an SO3 cross SO3. Okay? The cross just means that if I take an element of this group, it commutes with an element of that group. So these are truly distinct groups. I just crammed them together. Now remember, please, because this gets confusing, this is not a split into rotations and boosts. Okay? It's not. You ready? You ready? Good. These transformations are based on the J and the K boost and rotation matrices, which are 4 by 4 matrices. They act on vectors. Or you can talk about a scalar, you can talk about tensors. If we would like to uncover spinners, what should we do? Well, what is SO3 equivalent to? SU2. So how about we do this? Again, this makes total sense because this has got 3 generators, as does this. 3 generators, 3 generators. You have to have the same number of generators if you're ever going to argue that two groups are roughly the same. Okay? Here's where it sucks. Mm-hmm. What are these going to act on?
Spinners.
Spinners, which have how many components?
Two.
2.
So I'm going to have a 2-component spinner from this one, and a 2-component spinner from this one. So all together, how many components is my spinner going to have?
4. Well, that sucks. How many components does a vector have in 4 dimensions?
4.
A vector has 4 components and a spinner has 4 components. In non-relativistic quantum mechanics, you'd never confuse a spinner and a vector. In non-relativistic quantum mechanics, a vector has 3 components and the spinner has 2. In relativistic mechanics, a vector has 4 components and the spinner has 4 components. Aren't they the same damn thing? The answer is no. Remember, the 4 components of a vector are its T component, its X component, its Y components, and its Z component. TX, YZ. No, I mean, there's no simple connection between this and the coordinates. Go ahead.
So when we wrote it as SO3, wouldn't that...
So
here. Wouldn't that kind of imply that there are 6-dimensional vectors by that same, or 9-dimensional, like however that 2-component spinner with the 2-component spinner made 4? Why doesn't then SO3 make a 6-component vector or 9?
Yeah, you could do a 6-dimensional representation.
Okay.
Yeah, you can do that.
But that would just be dumb.
I mean, a 4-dimensional representation in terms of real matrices is more efficient.
Right.
But you could do a 6-component representation. Remember their square? You could do many different dimensions of representations. We're getting down to the smallest, though, because we're down to 2x2 using complex matrices. Yeah?
What is that, like, combining them actually doing? Is it, like...
What do you mean?
Just across, like, SU2 cross SU2.
Well, let me ask you a question. Could that be true?
No.
No, why?
Well, because SU2 is equivalent to SU3.
Well, how many generators does this have?
6.
How many does this have?
3.
Well, there's no way these two could be equal. So I need 6 generators on this side, and here's a simple way to do it. Because this has got 3, this has got 3, you add the number of generators.
Like, what are you doing to combine
them? Well, you can take the cross to mean this.
Okay.
It means if I take an element of this group and I commute it with an element of this group, I get 0.
Okay.
I mean, this cross is this structure right here. Basically, that's what it is. Okay. I mean, it's a direct product, but I don't want to get into the nitty-gritty details of that. I mean, there's also semi-direct products, which is going to be important if we want to talk about translations as well, but I don't want to go there. Really don't want to go there. Okay, so I'm just going to end with this note. First of all, it sucks that spinners in 4 dimensions have 4 components, because vectors do too, you know, and you'd think they're the same, but for example, they do not transform the same at all. And we're going to talk about the transformations next time, okay? But, you know, I know what you want to know. What about 5 dimensions? How does this play out? And I'll just give you a little chart. So a vector and a spinner. If I'm in 3D, 4D, 5D, a vector has how many components in 3D?
3.
Spinner?
2.
In 4D, a vector?
4.
A spinner?
4.
In 5D, a vector?
5.
Right. How many do you think a spinner has?
6.
You're literally just guessing, so.
6.
8.
52.
Or 60. It's got 3.
What?
I know. So the spinners always lose. I mean, they might catch up, but then they're going to lose. That's what sucks about spinners. So in 6D, what do you think?
Six.
Six and?
Six.
Four.
Five.
Eight.
What?
What?
Yeah. That was
God bless the spinners. What do you think about 7D? What do you think about 7D? What about vectors?
Seven.
What about spinners?
Eight.
Hey, you guys are getting the pattern. 8D. Spinners. I mean vectors.
Eight.
Spinners.
16.
What about 9D? Nine. What about spinners? 16. What about 10D? Vectors. 10. Spinners.
32.
Thank you very much. Now, again, guys, if you want me to tell you how spinners carry so much more information about the space than vectors do, there you go. Okay. Now, you might be looking at this. Trust me, the calculation of this is actually straightforward once you dig into it enough, and you do it at an arbitrary number of dimensions instead of four or three. But basically what you're doing is the following. You're taking your space with however many dimensions it has, and you're picking independent planes. So I could do X and Y, so that can be one plane, and then I could do Z and W, that's another plane. And, well, I've got five dimensions, this guy doesn't have an extra, I can't put him with an independent plane, right? I mean, if this is a V. VY shares Y with that, okay? For each independent plane, you can form an SU2. All right? And each SU2 contributes a two-dimensional object. Okay? However, these are not crossed. So these are not added. Okay? Rather, these states are multiplied in a sense. Okay? So the total number of states you get here is four, but if you add it in another plane, say the VQ plane, then again you get a two-dimensional spinner, and the total number of states is 2^3, which is 8. That's why in 6 dimensions your spinner has 8 components. In 5 dimensions your spinner only has 4 because you've only got 2 independent planes, so you get the same story as 4 dimensions. Okay. So in general, it's 2^(d/2) for d even, and 2^(d-1/2) for d odd. And I can do it, but I didn't. Okay. So, we're going to stick in 4 dimensions, so we're going to work with 4-component spinners. The main lesson I want you to, and of course, by the way, as you all know, I have worked with those extensively, because that's the string theory context, but we're not going to do string theory in this class. But the one important lesson I want you to draw from this discussion, and it's a carryover from your intuition from quantum mechanics, but it's kind of weird here. A 4-component spinner is not a 4-component vector. The components mean different things, and their transformation laws are very different. Okay? We know how to transform a vector. We know what a 4x4 rotation matrix looks like. We know what a 4x4 boost matrix looks like. Now we have to figure out what a 4x4 rotation matrix for spinners looks like, and what a 4x4 boost matrix for spinners looks like. Okay, and we'll talk about that next time. All right, that's it.